In this lecture, we'll be seeing some basics of CPM and PERT. CPM stands for Critical Path Method and PERT stands for Program or Project Evaluation and Review Technique. These are the important tools which are used in project management. Project management is that way a big area. The optimization perspective of project management is handled by CPM and PERT. CPM and PERT are basically used for finding the critical path. And another optimization requirement as far as the project is concerned is that the project should get completed in minimum time or it should take minimum cost to complete the project. This perspective, this thing of completing the project in minimum time or minimum cost is handled by the tool called as crashing of the network. Sometimes the requirement is that the resources required by various activities to be performed on various days should be leveled, right? For example, it may sometimes happen that a project will be requiring two man days. On certain days, it will be requiring two man hours, two manpower, for example, and the next day it may require 15 manpower, and third day it may require three, and this is how the manpower requirement for on various days will keep on fluctuating. But it's not a good practice to have the fluctuating manpower requirement on daily basis, right? So it will always be desirable to have the leveled or almost equal manpower requirement every day till the project gets completed. So this is called as leveling or smoothening resource leveling or smoothening. So these are by and large the perspectives, optimization perspective of project management. There are many other things in project management, but these are particularly dealt in operations research. In this lecture, however, we'll be seeing how to use CPM and PERT for finding the critical path. Basically, CPM and PERT also is used for finding the critical path. Now, before we see what is critical path, it becomes important for us to know what is project. Project is characterized by the presence of many activities. Maybe there are thousands, 10,000, lakhs of activity in project, and these activities, all of them will not be starting all at once. There is interdependence in between the activities. Some activities will be starting after the completion of some other activities. And on completion of these activities, some other activities will be starting, right? Some activities will not depend on completion of anything, and such activities are called as starting activities. And there are some activities after completion of which no activity start. Those will be called as ending activities. Right? So having understood about the project that it is characterized by the number of activities which are dependent on the completion of each other, right? Then what is activity? Activity is something which consumes resources. It may consume manpower, materials, machine, energy, money, so many resources are there. So, and also the time. Activity is something which consumes time to complete it, right? Along with another resources, right? So, having understood activity, now it becomes important to know the difference between CPM and PERT in the light of whatever we have seen and so far. CPM and PERT, CPM is already defined, already told to you that it is critical path method, and PERT is program or project evaluation and review technique. So, the domain of the things dealt in PERT are little more than what is dealt in CPM. CPM came into existence before PERT. So when CPM came, it was every activity involved in the project was assumed to get completed in certain stipulated time, which was fixed. Okay, so CPM is a deterministic approach. It assumes that any activity will get completed in fixed time required to complete that activity. It will not be taking lesser time than the stipulated time or more time. It will not be taking lesser or more time. Whereas PERT assumes that activity will get completed in certain time span, right? So it assumes that the activity completion time is probabilistic. And in earlier days, there used to be the concept of three time estimates for completing any activity. We'll be seeing that concept as we enter into the problem. Then, the another important difference in CPM and PERT approach, CPM is activity oriented. Now there are two things as we have seen just before, seeing the difference between CPM and PERT, that there is something called as activity, and the beginning and ending of the activity are the events. Okay, so CPM is activity oriented and PERT is event oriented. Right, all the computations in PERT are focused on the nodes, event, starting event of the activity, starting of the activity. Whereas CPM assumes that the activity can be plotted within two times. Right, so it is activity oriented. And in CPM literature, we find float. Right, we can float the activity in between two times. We can start it sometime later the actual starting point and finish it sometime before the actual finishing time. So all in all, it is activity oriented and based on the concept of floating the activity, whereas PERT is event oriented, and we find out the slack in or by what amount certain event or starting of the activity can be delayed, can be slackened, right? So these are major differences in CPM and PERT. Nowadays, we do not keep discussing and the differences between CPM and PERT. Those are interchangeably used. Means we use the term CPM when PERT is to be used and PERT when CPM is to be used, or sometimes these terms are used combinedly. CPM PERT, right? It is talked like CPM PERT. So let's not go much into the difference in between CPM and PERT. We may be taking one problem on CPM to find out various floats in case of CPM, right? We majorly will be dealing with the project through the point of view of PERT. And while we will be looking at the project through PERT perspective, PERT perspective, we'll be seeing the CPM computations to some extent, right? CPM emulation of PERT we will be seeing in short, but not in detail, all right? So now let's look at this problem. And as we go through various contents of the problem, we will be seeing various things required by the contents of the problem, so that the theory, some theory required to handle this problem is understood there itself, because the significance of that theory will be just in front of you, right? So, as I said, that Project is comprised of many activities which depend on another activities. So dependency is very important characteristic of the project. For example, here you are seeing that the project, it is a very small project because you have to learn what kind of analysis is carried out on a project. So it should be a manageable project so that I can explain it to you. Once this is explained, most of the project management thing you have to do on project management software, right? So in this project, you have how many activities? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 activities are there. Okay, what these activities are, their description may be something, but for us to progress the thing ahead, we have labeled those that description as A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. Okay, because our analysis is not going to get affected because of the description of the activity. What we need in our analysis, particularly in optimization, simply the labels given to the description. That's enough for us, right? So there are 10 activities labeled as A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. Now, as far as activity A, B are concerned, they are not dependent on any activity. That means they are starting activity. Now, activities C, D, and E are dependent on completion of activity A, right? So, after activity A gets completed, C, D, and E will be starting. Then activity F starts after completion of activity B and C, right? B and C, when they will complete together, might be it happens that B gets completed earlier and C gets completed later. So obviously, activity F will be starting after completion of the activity which completes later. Like out of B and C, if C completes later, activity F will be starting after completion of C. If B completes later, then activity F will be starting after completion of B. That is to say, B and C's combined completion will make activity F start. Right? Activity G will start after completion of C, H will start after combined completion of C and D, right? Whichever completes later. I starts at the completion of D, and J starts on completion of I and F. So this kind of dependency will be given to you. Okay, there is one way of explaining you the dependency. There are many other ways. Another way of explaining the dependency will be drawing the network diagram in which the dependency will be clearly visible. Just by seeing the diagram, you will very readily, easily come to know which activity depends on the completion of which activity, right? There is another approach of indicating the dependency that is called the matrix method. Adjacency matrix will also be telling you the dependence of the activity, right? So that is also one way, or you may come out with some other way of representing the dependence of the activity on the dependence in between the activity. So this is one thing. We will be trying to present this information in form of network, right? And this presentation has to be 1:1. That means that network, if I once again find the information, it should be uniquely like this. That network should, if I want to tabulate the dependency information, it should get tabulated like this and this only, right? So that is very important thing about converting this information to network. We'll be seeing that just now. But before that, you look at the project completion duration information. There are three time estimates given here, TO, TM, and TP. Now it becomes important for us to know what is this TO, TM, and TP. As I said, that PERT is a probabilistic approach, and this is one way of representing the activity completion duration probabilistically. Right, this is a very primitive way of explaining project completion duration in probabilistic way. So as you are finding, the TO is the least time to which is required to complete the activity, TM is somewhere in between, and TP is a maximum time. Okay, now what is this TO, TM, and TP? Right, TO stands for optimistic time, right? Like you see here, TO stands for optimistic time, right? Optimistic time means what? The time required to complete the activity, time required to complete the activity, if everything required for completing or everything or most of the things required to complete the project are in favor of completion, not complete the project, complete the activity, are in favor of completing the activity, are favorable to complete the activity. Right? So, in that case, obviously, the activity completion time will be minimum. Right, that is called as optimistic time, because it is optimism that everything required to complete the activity is in favor of the activity at that point of time, right, in that situation particularly. So that is called as optimistic time, and that is minimum. Then another time, like you are seeing, is pessimistic time, right? Pessimistic time, you must have understood what it is. Pessimistic time means the time required to complete the activity in a situation when the factors responsible for completing the activity are not in favor of the completion of the activity. For example, if the man is there, material is not there. If the material is there, machine is not there. Some or other thing is delaying the completion of activity. Okay, or when all the things are there, then the environment is not in favor of the completion of the activity, it suddenly starts raining. So all these factors taken together will be responsible for completing the activity in more time, right? So that is called as TP, pessimistic time, right? But as you know that the situations are not always favorable, and they are not unfavorable too. Okay, most often some of the circumstances will be favorable and some will be unfavorable. So the time required to complete the activity in such situation is a mid time. Okay, it will be in between TO and TPA, that is optimistic time minimum, pessimistic time maximum, and in between time is most likely time, right? So why this word most likely is used? Because when the study was carried out for determining the activity completion time, it was found that the proportion of TO, TM, and TP is 1:4:1. That is to say, if this activity, for example, A is studied for 6 times for its project completion time, then it is found that activity A gets completed in TO time once, in TP time once, and it will be completed in most likely time 4 times out of 6 times, right? So having known this proportion, having known this frequency of occurrence of the completion time, it becomes easy for us to find expected time, right? Expected time is found as frequency. It will be simply summation of frequency multiplied by the completion time divided by total of frequency, right? So 1 into TO, because TO occurs once, plus 4 into TM, because TM occurs, activity will be completed in TM time 4 times. So 4 into TM plus 1 into TP divided by 1 plus 4 plus 1, that is 6, right? So by using this formula, which is very obvious one, you will be finding expected time to complete the activity. Ultimately, everything, all the probabilistic data, you have to convert to average data. And that's what we are doing here. If it was some other distribution, we would have found out average in that case. All right. And then standard deviation in that case is found out as found out by a simple formula, that is the span between TP and TO, that is TP minus TO divided by 6, right? Standard deviation is found by TP minus TO divided by 6, all right? Then, as we have found out mu and sigma, we will be mostly referring to normal distribution table. But in fact, the activity completion time follows what is called as beta distribution. Okay, what is the difference between beta and normal distribution? Beta distribution, normal distribution, as you know, it extends at its both ends to infinity. That means it believes that extreme conditions to exist from minus infinity to plus infinity. Whereas in beta distribution, we do not allow the presence of extremities. We limit the distribution between two finite points. Okay, that is the difference between beta and normal distribution. Here you are finding this horizontal line. The normal distribution curve is asymptotic to horizontal line, whereas this touches the horizontal line, right? So the given three time estimate thing which you are seeing here, you will be converting to expected time and the standard deviation, like done here. Here you are saying, for example, activity A takes 1 TO. TO is 1. The times here may be in days, right? It takes 1 day. TM most likely time is 2 days and pessimistic time is 3 days. So to find expected time, what we'll be doing, we will be multiplying this time by 1, 1 into 1 plus 4 into 2 plus 1 into 3. That makes this total equal to 12, and that will be dividing by 6 to get expected time to 2. For example, let's come here. Let's come to this one. So it will be 8 plus 4 times 20 plus 38, right? How much? It is 80 plus 46, 126 divided by 6. That gives you time 21. So by simple formula, this multiplied by 1 plus this multiplied by 4 plus this multiplied by 1 divided by 6 will be getting you expected time. And you will also be required to find sigma for some later use. Okay, I would advise you to find sigma at the point when it is required. But because I had the formula, I have calculated it. But some of the values of sigma will not at all be needed. So if you calculate all the values of sigma, you will be calculating many of the values unnecessarily. Okay, but just to explain you the approach of finding the value of sigma, how it is done, 3 minus 1, that is Tp minus To divided by 6, it comes 0.33. For example, here 38 minus 8, 30 divided by 6, 5 it comes. So it's very easy to find, but better to find this value of sigma when the point of use of sigma comes in your problem. All right, so all this information we have converted into these two columns, out of which immediately we'll be needing this column only. Okay, so we will be now seeing how to draw the network based on this information, right? So it is very important for any problem on CPM and PERT to be able to draw, to be able to represent this information in table. Okay, so we now will be seeing how to represent this information in table. All right, sorry, how to represent the information given in the problem in the network. So drawing network may take sometimes few attempts to get a clean network. It is expected that the network representation of this information should be as clean as possible, so that your computations are very well done on the network itself. It is not that easy process. Sometimes for some problems it will be possible for you to draw the network very easily. For some problem it may take 2-3 attempts to get clean network. It is expected, but sometimes it may happen that some activity is crossing over some other activity. Okay, that is not much expected, but if it is inevitable, then we will allow that. But to the extent possible, you should get the network clean. Now, while you represent the information given in this problem or any such problem on the network, there are two approaches. Like here, one is called as AON, activity on node. Okay, means activity A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, you may represent on the node. You will be using node to represent the activity. That approach is called as AON, activity on node, right? Another approach which we generally follow is activity on arrow. And that makes sense to use this approach because we know that the activity consumes time, and that is better signified by the arrow, because it has got certain length, and the length signifies the time. Okay, it's not precise time, but it signifies the time. Okay, so activity on arrow, activity will be represented on arrow, is the approach we will be using, right? Because of the complexity of drawing the network many times, what is preferred by many softwares for representing the information in the network format, the approach which is used is Gantt chart, G-A-N-T-T, Gantt chart. And that is very popular in the software. It helps in very clear representation of the activities. Okay, right? It has more advantages of Gantt chart, has more advantages of relating it with calendar. Whereas these networks are not, it's not very feasible to represent calendar along with this network, or they draw this network while with the calendar, right? That is very much possible with Gantt chart. Okay, but whatever our analysis is, that is taking support of the network which we'll be drawing. This problem I have intentionally taken little tricky for drawing the network. Maybe the problems are not as tricky as this one is. Okay, so I could have started with a very simple problem, but I want you to go through various efforts of completing the network. All right, so we will be starting with our obvious understanding of drawing the network. For example, activity A and B, right? They are starting activity. So what you will be doing, you will be taking a starting node. For example, I take it here. All right. Then what I'll be doing, I'll be drawing activity A here and activity B here. Right? Activity A and activity B. They are starting activities. All right. Now, activity C, D and E depends on completion of activity A. Right. So here I will be taking some point to signify completion of activity A. Let's say this point signifies completion of activity A. And then what is happening? Activity C, I can draw here, and obviously I'll be drawing here it in sequence, but sometimes I may have to alter the sequence for my requirement of completing the network in a clean way, or my requirement of getting clean network, right? So let's say this is C, this is D, and this is E, right? Now it is very clear from this that C, D, E starts on the completion of A. Alright, then come to next information, activity F starts on completion of B and C. Right, now B activity is here and C is here. And I will have to combine these two activity at certain node, because node is signifying the completion of the activity, starting of the activity. So B being here and C being here, it becomes difficult for me to think of a node which will be joining B and C together. Okay. So what I'll be doing, because I am foreseeing that having B on this side will complicate the things. So I am yet to progress ahead. So right at this point, I may cancel this B from here and will prefer to have B on this side, right? To the extent possible, they should be drawn straight lines. But here, because I want to connect B with C, right? Because why I want to connect B with C? Activity F starts on completion, as you are seeing here, activity F starts on completion of activity B and C, as you are seeing here, right? F starts on completion of B and C together. So this is my activity B, which I am shifting from this side to this side. You know why I am shifting, right? So here is B, okay? So this together signifies the completion of activity B and C together. I could have drawn it straight, okay, but that doesn't make much of a difference while you draw the network. In books, you will be finding the networks drawn mostly with straight lines, okay, right? So activity F is starting on completion of B and C, right? F is starting on completion of B and C, right? Then activity G is starting on C, completion of C only. Now, if you suppose say draw certain activity, activity G, right here, okay, are you seeing? activity G right here. Okay, it will be wrong to draw activity G like this here because it is not giving you the precise information, it is not interpreting the precise information given in the table. What is given in the table? Activity C depends on completion of G. And what you, sorry, activity G depends on completion of C. But here, what we are seeing, it depends on completion of B and C together. So this is wrong. I cannot draw activity G here like that, right? So what I'll be doing to manage the completion of, to manage starting of activity G only after completion of C, just see here what I do, and that's what you may be required to do in many situations. You will be required to do in many situations. So what I'll be doing, I will not be drawing, I will not be drawing activity C here. Because drawing that activity C here is creating an issue of representing activity G. So I will be removing activity C from here. Okay, this is my rough attempt and I am going to pair it after some corrections. So activity C I will be drawing like this. Okay, this is activity C, this is activity D, this is activity C. Alright. And C is completing here. So after completion of C, I am now able to draw G. Okay. And now, how to manage the completion of B and C together. So for managing the completion of B and C together, I plan a dummy activity. Okay, some join, dummy join in between these two. This dummy activity is the activity which will be taking zero time, consuming zero resources. It is just used for the convenience of drawing the network. It doesn't have any other purpose. Okay, because I want to have a join of B and C together, but that join is creating some problem as you have seen. Okay, so I wanted that C should be drawn at some other place and C and B will be joined together by what is called as dummy activity. This is as good as continuation of C, but it won't be consuming any resource, any time. So this is the point of intersection of activity, not intersection, completion of B and C, whereafter activity F starts. Now this is clearly reinterpreting what you need to interpret out of it. Activity F will be starting after completion of B and C, and activity G will be starting after completion of C only. So till G, we have been doing, we have done the activities well, right? Now come to H. Okay, might be there are some more complications ahead. H depends on completion of C and D, and read one information ahead, that is I depends on completion of D only. Oh, here is the problem. Okay, when you look in the dependency column, if you find that some activity like here, like for example here, D exists here, D exists here too. And here there is some more activity C. Then it guarantees that this will be represented by dummy activity as we did in this case. Activity here depends on B and C, and there is another activity which depends only on C. So when there is one activity common and others are different, then you will have to represent that dependence by using dummy activity. Okay, so by our experience which we have just got, we will be handling this situation in the light of what happened, what we did while handling activity F and G. So activity I depends on completion of D. Okay, so what I'll be doing, I'll be managing the completion of D somewhere here. Okay, and I starts on completion of D. That's fine. Here is activity I. Right? Now I'll come to H. H depends on completion of C and D. So C is here, D is here. So C and D will be meeting at certain point, and that certain point, that certain node, we realize by drawing dummy activities from C as well as from completion of C as well as from completion of D. This point will be signifying completion of C and D together, okay, and that completion will be getting you activity H, right? So we are trying to honor whatever information is available to us in the tables. Okay, we are not exceeding on the front of dependency, and we are not ignoring any dependence. Okay, and lastly, J depends on completion of I and F. Okay, so again we will be in little bit of trouble, right? So here F is here and I is here. Okay, so far we have tried that every activity will be taking its own path, but what we are seeing here, F is on this side and I is on this side, and that is the only thing which I am not able to cleanly manage. What I'll be doing, I will be allowing this I activity to cross over, but that is not the intersection. I'll be taking this curved thing over the over this activity just to signify that they are not intersecting. Here also I'll be taking a curve and I'll be asking these two activities to join. So I and F are joining, right, and activity J is starting after on the join of I and F, right? And now there is no activity after G, there is no activity after H, or there is no activity which depends on the completion of G, H and E. So all such activities you have to converse to one point called as ending node. So this G I am extending here, and this H I am extending, and this is E also which I am extending here. This is the project completion. This node signifies project completion. All right. So it took me to do certain correction while I was drawing the network. Maybe in some other network you are not required to do any correction, and in the first go itself you will be getting the network completed. All right. You'll be getting the network completed, but in some network like this one, it may take one or two attempts. Some attempts we have managed in this first attempt itself, by for example, by cancelling this, by shifting activity C from here to here. Now we'll be doing this network little bit here. All right. So that I'll be doing on another page. So that you view this dependency information in a clean way to the extent possible, right? I'll be using this network just to draw. I'll be drawing a better network from my attempt earlier, okay? So let's see how do I do it. Okay, I'll be doing it on another page, because I have to do some more things on the network. So, right? So A and B, as you are seeing, A and B. Let me keep it like this one. A and B. Till this point. Right? So I'll be drawing A downwards and B upwards. right? So here is my starting point. Okay, B I want to draw upward and A downward. Okay, and that I decided in my first attempt itself that whenever I will be making fair copy of this, I will be having A down and B up. Okay, and then when the activity A completes, your activity C, D and E starts. So A completes here and activity C, D and E will be starting like this. C, D and E. Okay, I have drawn temporarily it like that, and I'll go on labeling so that the dependency information goes on getting verified as soon as I draw the activity. C, D, E depends on completion of A, that's fine, right? Then I have activity F which depends on completion of B and C, and activity G which depends on completion of on completion of C. Okay, so when C completes, let's say C completes here, and activity G will be starting like this. Activity G. Here I draw activity G. Okay. Might be if there are some issues while I draw this, because you, as you are seeing, that this time I am drawing it much better than I have drawn it earlier. Okay. But it's not guaranteed that this will be the last attempt of it. Right. Then activity F depends on completion of B and C. B and C. So activity B is here and C is here. Right. I'll be extending it like this one. Okay. And here I'll be drawing a node. Right. And I want F to start after completion of B and C together. So B is completing here and C is actually completing here, but just to manage the B and manage B and C completion together, I will be drawing the dummy activity. I'll be drawing dummy activity. Dummy activity is to be drawn by dotted line. Okay, when you draw a dotted, it signifies that it is dummy, it is not taking any time, it is not consuming any resource. Okay, so this node is the join of B and C together. Activity F will be starting on completion of B and C. All right, so I'll be drawing F like this. Okay, and what I am seeing, yep, I have drawn. Then I have to draw activity G and H. G I have already drawn, and H starts on completion of C and D together. Okay, so if you recall your earlier attempt, what we did, activity, but before that, activity G depends on completion of C, that's fine, and activity H depends on completion of C and D together. Okay, so here is D, all right, and yes, you don't need two activities to come together, right? Yes, there will be a need in future, all right? Because there is activity I which will be starting on completion of D. Okay, so what I'll be doing, I will be drawing activity I on completion of D, and that activity I will be meeting to J. I will be meeting activity I, which I start from D, will be meeting to this app. Okay, so I will have to take this way. But before I draw activity I, let me draw activity H, which starts on completion of C and D together. Okay, so I cannot draw a dummy line from here to here, because this point then will be signifying completion of activity C and D together, where after I will be drawing activity H, but I won't be able to draw activity I, right? So what I'll be doing to, as a way out of this, I'll be taking a node in between these two, and I will be joining this node by with this node by dummy activity. So this point is signifying join of C and D together. Completion of C and D together, after which activity H starts. Activity H starts after this. Alright? Activity H starts. This is H. Right? Then, after the completion of D, activity I starts. So after completion of D, if I take I this way, it will take long for I to reach to F, right? So what I'll be doing, I will be taking this path for activity I. It will cross over H, it will cross over G, but will not intersect, and it will meet F. So let's dare to cross over this. Okay, so here it goes like this. So you take this path like this, okay, and then like this, and then let them meet at one point. So this is activity I. Okay, I and F are meeting at this point. Okay, and after the completion of I and F, activity J is starting. Okay, activity J is starting. All right, and I'll be taking it down. Okay, this is activity J, and activity J, the on the completion of J, on the completion of G, H and E, there is no activity starting. So all these activities, you will have to converge at a point, and all these activities will be ending activities, right? So I'll be bringing G to this point. I'll be bringing H also to this point, and I'll be bringing E also to this point, right? All these activities will be meeting at this point. So this network is to a greater extent clean one, except for this activity. And as far as I believe, that it will be very difficult to remove the crossing of this activity over activity G and H. If you try to remove this crossing over the activity I over G and H, there will be some other crossover somewhere else. Okay, so the point is, you have to make a network as clean as possible. Okay, it is said in literature that there should not be, literature means in textbooks, some textbooks, it is mentioned that there is no crossing of one activity over other, right? But I will advise, if it is inevitable, just manage, just instead of drawing this line, straight line, you just take two curves over the existing activities, right? Now that this dependency diagram is done, once again you verify whether this diagram is giving you only information, only information given in this table. All right? It should not give anything extra, or you should not give any less information than available in the table. Now, this information on this network, what you draw, what you do, you post the expected time to complete each of the activity. For example, activity A takes how much days to complete? 2. It takes 2 days to complete. So I'll be posting the duration here. Then activity B takes 6 days to complete. Okay. Activity C takes 12 days to complete. Okay, C takes 12 days to complete. D takes again 12 days to complete. D also takes 12 days to complete. E takes 10 days to complete. All right. And then what is that? F takes 21 days. F takes 21 days to complete. And G takes 8 days to complete. Alright. G takes 8 days and H also takes 8 days. So that you post the duration on this. Okay. H also takes 8 days. Right, then I take 17 days. I take 17 days. This is activity I and it is taking 17 days. All right, then J is taking 18 days. Where is J? J is taking 18 days. So all the information given in the table is almost posted on this network, except for the standard deviation of the activity. All the durations which are posted in this network are the expected times, mean times, average times. Okay, so what we will be getting at the end of analysis will be average project completion duration, right? So we will be having our answers in probabilistic terms, all right? So we are going with average, right? Had this been CPM problem, you would have had directly this information available to you, that activity A takes 2 days, activity B takes 6 days. Okay, you will not be having TOTM TP estimates. Whatever will be available to you will be the only time that activity requires to complete, right? And you will be proceeding ahead in the network with that information as we will be doing now, right? So now we will be finding critical path for this network, okay, right? So for finding critical path, there are various approaches, but this approach is very simple, right? This approach which we will be seeing now will be very simple. So what we will be doing, we'll be assuming that this project starts now at zero time. So as I said, that this is event oriented. So most of the information, activity duration is here, but our analysis, whatever analysis we do, will be available at the nodes only, right? So here, the earliest start time, TE, T stands for earliest start time. This will be zero for this node because we will be starting this node now. We'll be constructing this project. Okay. We will be interested in knowing when a particular node will realize. For example, this node will realize node, this node. Let me label this node so that you identify this node. There is one particular style of labeling this node, right? These nodes are labeled as 10, 20, 30, 40. As we proceed ahead, these nodes are labeled. Why 10, 20? Because sometimes it may happen that you have skipped certain activity and that is required to be inserted in between 10 and 20, for example. Okay. So what number you will be giving to that? You may be giving 11, 12, 13, 14. You have 10 number available which you can give to 10 forgotten activities. Right? So normal style of labeling the notes is 10, 20, 30. Sometimes they are labeled as 100, 200, 300, so on in big projects. Right? So I hope you understood how the notes are labeled, but for what I'll be doing, I'll be labeling them in simple style as 1, 2, sorry, I should label this as 2 and that as 3. Okay, this is labeled as 3. Okay, then this as 4, this as 5, this as 6, okay, this as 7. This is 8. So how many activities are there? There are 10 activities and there are 8 notes. Okay. And all our calculations will occur at node. So this node, node 1 comes into existence at 0 time is now. Node 2 will be coming into existence at time equal to when this node comes into existence plus this time 2. So TE here will be equal to 2. And what will be TE here? That will be coming into existence after 6 days. Okay. That is TE here plus activity duration. And when I draw the activities, I must show the arrows which I have forgotten. Okay. So this activity is toward this, then activity C, D and E, right? Then this dummy activity has this kind of orientation toward this, then this is, these arrows are important so that you come to know the direction of dependence, right? Right. Now, if I want to find, because I have TE here, one may think that I can find out TE here. Earliest start time, earliest occurrence of this node, I can find, but this not that that simple, because TE here will be found by all the connections, all the arrows leading towards 8. Right, so we will be finding TE here just by these arrows. What about this and what about this? Okay, for that, the TE that other nodes need to be known. So I will be in position to find TE here. Okay, I should not have found TE here. That was a mistake because there are two arrows coming to this direction. So until I am in position to find TE of the tail of that activity, I won't be able to find TE of this node, earliest occurrence of this node. So that was mistake. Okay. TE I am able to find here because to this node there is only one arrow and TE here is 2. So from here I will be able to find TE here. Why? Because there is only one arrow leading to this node. Okay. And because of that, TE here will be 2 plus 12, 14. Okay. TE here will be 14. Right. And now there are two arrows leading to this node. I'll be finding TE by both the arrows. So this activity duration is 0. So 14 plus 0 is 14. And by this, it is 0 plus 6 is 6. So whichever is more, because this node is the starting node for F. And F can start only after completion of B and C together. Okay. So this node occurs, this node realizes when at t is equal to 14, right? Whichever is greater will be giving you te there, not 6, it will be 14. Okay, te by this arrow you have found that came 6, and te by this arrow that is coming equal to 14. So whichever is greater, you have to take that. Okay, now that you have got te here, now you think of finding te here. You can find te here. Why? Because there is only one arrow leading to this node 5. Okay, and how you will be finding te there? 2 plus 12, 14. Right? Now I have, now if I think of this node, there are two arrows leading to this node. One from here where t is equal to 14 and this activity duration is 0. So t here by this will be coming equal to 14, and by this also it will be coming equal to 14. So t here is 14, right? T e here is equal to 14, right? Now am I able to find t e here? Because there are two arrows. For being able to find TE here, you should be in position to, you should have TE of the tails of the arrows coming to this node. TE at tails of the arrows coming to this node. You have TE here, you have TE here too. So TE here can be found as higher among these two, 14 plus 21, that is 35. Via this, then 14 plus 17, that is 24 plus 7, 31, right? 35 is more, so T here will be 35, right? T there will be 35, and now the only node where T is required to be, is remaining to be found is this one, right? So there are how many arrows? This is one, this is second, this is third, this is fourth. You just make sure that for all, at all the tails, at the tails of all these arrows, whether the TE is calculated or not. Here at the tail of this arrow, I have TE. At the tail of this arrow, I have TE. At the tail of this arrow, I have TE. At the tail of this arrow as well, I have TE. So by this, if I calculate, it is coming out to be 2 plus 10, 12. Okay. By this, if I calculate 35 plus 18, it will be 53. By this, 14 plus 8, 22. And by this also, 14 plus 8, 22. So 53 amongst all this is maximum. So TE for this node is 53, okay? So one thing is clear, that this project will get completed in 53 days, right? This project will get completed in 53 days, right? But I want to know which are the activities responsible for completing this project in 53 days, right? So what I'll be doing, I will start doing the backward calculation as if I am destroying this project, but in the backward time scale, right? So what I'll be doing now, I will be taking the backward pass from 53rd day, and here I'll be having what is called as TL, okay? I'll be computing TLs, that is latest occurrence of this node, TL will be equal to 53, right? TL will be equal to TE for last node, because that is the starting of backward pass. Okay, TL will be equal to TE. Now you go on going to previous node, backward node. And if there is only one tail now, When we were taking forward pass, we were looking at arrow. Now when we will be taking backward pass, we will be looking at tail. Okay, if there is only one tail, finding the TL there will be easy. And while you are taking backward pass, you will be doing the subtraction. Okay, and you will be taking the minimum time if there are more than one tails. Okay, like you were taking maximum time when you were taking forward pass. When you will be taking backward pass, you will be taking minimum time. So TL here, I'll be writing bit neatly about TL here will be 53 minus 18. So TL here comes out to be 35. Okay, now when you are taking backward pass, you will be doing the subtraction. In forward pass, you will be doing the addition. Okay, and what about this? Is there only one tail coming to this node when I think of this arrow? No, there are multiple tails. Three tails are there. So I am not in position to find TL here. Okay, so forget about it. Okay, am I in position to find TL here? How many tails are there? There is only one tail. Okay, there is only one tail. So TL here will be 53 minus 8 is 45. TL here comes out to be equal to 45. Unfortunately, I have very less space, so you will have to understand what I write by what I speak, okay, then what you see, because the things may not be visible at times, okay. So TL, right, I'll be writing TLs in different inks so that the things will be visible clearly. Whatever written earlier TL, I'll be retaining them in that color, and now onwards I'll be writing TL in different colors, right? So TL here for this node, I'll be writing a little bit here. TL here is 45, right? Am I able to find TL at this node? Yes, I am, because this node has only one tail and that too coming from here. So I will be in position to find TL here. 53 minus this activity duration, 53 minus 8, 45. So TL means latest occurrence. TL is not standing for tail. Incidentally, TL and tail are some way associated. Okay, so TL is 45. So here TL is equal to 45. Okay, now once again the question, am I able to find TL here? Yes, because there was only one tail. Okay, so TL here will be equal to 35 minus 21, that is 14. Okay, that is 14, right? Then coming to this node, okay, am I able to find TL here? Because so far I have the TLs of everything ahead. So obviously I'll be coming to this node, and this has three tails. You will be computing TL by all the paths. Okay, TL via this part, 53 minus 10, that is coming 43, right? Okay, I have forgotten to point TL here. Okay, and can I, because there are two tails here. So by this path, 35 minus 17, so it is coming, getting you 18 by this path. And by this path, what is the TL here? 45 minus 0, 45. So by this path, you are getting it 18. And by this path, you are getting it 45. So whichever is lesser, you have to take that as TL. When you do backward pass calculations, if you are getting multiple TLs at certain point, you have to take minimum. And when you will be doing forward pass calculation, you will be doing the addition, and wherever there are multiple T's you will be getting, you will be taking maximum, right? So TL here comes out to be equal to 35 minus 17, 18. All right. I think I am ready to find TL here. So 53 minus 10 got me 43. That you keep in mind. And then 18 minus 12, that is getting you 6, right? And why are this 45? 45 minus 12 is getting you 33, right? So amongst 33 and 6 and 43, 6 is minimum, right? 6 is minimum. So whichever is minimum, that is the TL here, right? And now, am I in position to find TL here? Yes, you are, because you have two tails and you have the TLs available at the arrow ends of this activity. You know TL here. So that is 14 minus 14 minus 6, that is 8, and you get it via this. I'm sorry, I was little wrong in computation of TL here. Okay. Because you see, I was in hurry to find the number of tails here. I said to you that this is the only one tail, but I forgot that this is also the tail here. So while computing TL here, I must take into account TL here, which was found immediately after TL here, because there was only one tail, precisely one tail. Okay, and that is clearly visible here. So TL here was found by 35 minus 21, that is equal to 14. Now for finding TL here, you just see, by this it is coming out to be 53 minus 8, 45. By this way, it is coming out to be 14 minus 0, it is 14. Okay, so that was wrong. Having it equal to 43 was wrong. It is 14 only. It is 14. Okay. And now, because that TL is 14, probably I will have to calculate TL here. Okay. By this path, I know that it is coming equal to 53 minus 10, 43. Clear? Then from this node, due to this activity, it is coming equal to 18 minus 12, 6, okay, which I wrote, but that is wrong. 14 by this path, I am getting it 14 minus 12, 2. So this TL should be equal to 2, okay. And now that I have this TL equal to 2, I am in position to find this TL here. So 14 minus 6, it is giving you 8. Via this path, and via this path, it is 2 minus 2, 0. And for the starting node, it must come equal to 0. Alright? If it is not coming equal to 0, then you have done some wrong calculation somewhere. So you have to recheck it, and because of that only, I was forced to recheck the thing, and that brought the mistake in my view. Okay, so that is how I have found TL. I have found earliest occurrence time and I have found latest occurrence time for all the nodes. Now I will be finding the slack at the nodes. When we were talking about the differences between PERT and CPM and PERT, we saw that CPM finds floats, and that float is related with the activity, whereas PERT points slacks. That slacks are related with the node. Okay, everything here we are finding with respect to node. All right. So slack is the difference between TL minus TE. So slack here is coming out to be equal to 0, means TL minus TE Here it is coming out to be equal to 0 slack. Okay. Here also it is coming out to be equal to 0. Right. Wherever possible and I am able to write easily, I am writing this. Okay, slack, because it depends on TE and TL, so I can of that particular node, so I can find slack in any sequence, but there is a definite sequence of finding TE and TL. Right, slack here is coming out to be equal to 0. Slack here also is coming out to be equal to 14 minus 14, that is coming equal to 0. Okay. Slack here, 14 minus 18, that is coming equal to 6. Alright, then slack here, this is 14 minus 45, but I will have to check that again, for 53 minus 8, 45, and there is only one tail, so 45. So slack for this node, okay, slack for this node is 45 minus 14, that is too big, that is coming out to be 31, am I right? Yes, 31. So I'll be taking a little more space because there is no point in writing that information in a clumsy way. I'll be taking a red arrow outside, and here slack at that point I'll be writing 35. Okay, that is the difference between TL and TE. Elsewhere, everywhere I have written the slack. Now, for finding critical path, you have to connect all the activities which start with zero slack and end with zero slack. Okay, but there is one more point. Before you connect the nodes with each other, right, the nodes which are to be connected should have zero slack. That is one condition. Okay, all this we are discussing for finding the critical path, right, that I have not mentioned at the beginning of the problem, right? Here we are mentioning it. So you must have wondered so far what for we are discussing all this. But in the process of discussion, you have understood some of the things, how to find expected time, how to find standard deviation, how to draw the network, how to find TEs, how to find TLs, how to find slack. Now coming to the real purpose of doing all this, that is finding the critical path. Okay, so for finding the critical path, you have to join the nodes with zero slack. But before joining the node, one point you must remember that here you have zero slack, and here also you have zero slack. Okay. Now there is a temptation of joining this node with this node, because I have said you that you have to join the nodes with zero slack. But there is one more condition. Before you join, you check whether the TE here is coming because of TE here. And if the TE here is coming because of TE here, then only you have to join, otherwise not. So here, TE here is 14, that is not coming because of this. 0 plus 6 is 6, but that is 14. That means you cannot join these two nodes, okay? You cannot join this activity, right, even though the slack here and here is 0, right? You have to join the activity with 0 slack at the beginning and at the end. But one more condition must be observed, that TE here, if it is coming because of TE here, then only you have to join. Okay, now just check here. Slack here is 0 and slack here is 0. And you just verify whether the TE here is coming because of TE here. 0 plus 2 is getting me 0. So I must join this. Okay. So I am joining this by this kind of approach. Okay. By drawing hazy line. Okay, so this is signifying the critical path, critical activity. Okay, this activity is critical. Why it is critical, that I will be telling you after we get the critical path, complete critical path. Now you check here, this active slack here is 0 and slack here is 6. So there is no question of joining this node with this node. Again, there will be a question, this has slack 0 and this has slack 0. So can I join these nodes? Okay. The answer to that question comes from the question whether the T here is obtained from T here. T here is 53. So just find out 2 plus, what is this activity duration? 10. 2 plus 10 is 12. So not T here. This T here is not obtained because of this. So you cannot join this two nodes. This is already not in picture. Then come here. 2 plus 12 is 14. T here, because slack here is 0 and slack here is 0. So obviously there will be a question, should I join this node with this node? Right? So you can join this node with this node if and only if T here is obtained because of T here, and it is obtained because of T here, because 2 plus 12 is 14. So join this two. Alright? So you have joined. Now from this node, you find out the paths out. This is one path, this is another path, and this is third path. But before you check whether to join this node with this node is joined with this node only if slack here is 0. And the slack here is not 0, it is 35. Okay. So there is no question of this node join with this one. So can you join this with this? Okay. So here the slack is 0, here the slack is 0. But can you join is more decided by, is now decided by if T here is coming because of T here. So 14 plus 8 is 22 and T here is 53. So T here is not coming because of T here. So there is no question of joining. Now what remains is this only. So you will be joining this, but before that you check whether T here is coming because of this T. 14 plus 0 is 14. So this T is because of this. So you have to join this. So this activity will be on critical path, even though it is dummy, but that will be on critical path. Right? Mathematical critical path. Now, from this, there is only one activity out, and the slack here and here is 0, so you are bound to join this. Alright, you are bound to join this. And then, from this, there is only one activity out, and slack here is 0, slack here is 0. You better have the practice of verifying T at the arrow, whether it is obtained from T at the tail. So 35 plus 18 is 53, right? So T here is obtained because of that. So what you do? You join this two, right? So this is how you obtain critical path. I will be writing critical path. As A, C, dummy you may not write. It is good to be, it is just for showing on the network. Okay, this is dummy. Okay, it was not from the data available to us in table. So A, C, dummy is implied, then F and J. ACFJ, project completion duration. Project completion Project completion duration is equal to 53 days. All the data is in terms of days, so 53 days. So that you came to know, soon your calculations of TA were over, but you didn't got, you didn't get the critical path, and that you have got now. Now, what is the meaning of critical path? Critical path means the path, it is the continuous path of activities which determines the project completion duration, right? Suppose say this activity, instead of getting completed in 2 days, the project completion duration will be 54 days. How? Because you just seen that this duration you are getting because of this 2 plus 12 plus 21 plus 18. This is determining your project completion duration. Okay, for example, if you take another path starting from this node to this node, for example, this B, F and J, 6 plus 21 plus 18, how much it makes? 21 plus 18 is 39 plus 6, 45. Okay, so project will not get completed in 45 days, okay, because of the dependency of activities on another activity. Okay, because of that, the project will get completed in the maximum duration obtained as the sum of the activities from starting node to ending node. For example, you may take BFC, BFG as a path, you may take ACFJ as a path, or you may take ADH as a path, or you may take AE as a path, which will be taking you, and many other paths may be there in this network. So any path which is taking you maximum duration is the critical path. That is another way of finding critical path, but because it becomes difficult to find the path in network, we do not normally use that approach, right? So I hope you have understood how to find the critical path, right? All the if any activity on this critical path gets delayed by a day or two, or the project will get delayed by that much of delay in one or two activity, right? So if this activity gets completed in 3 days instead of 2 days, project completion duration will be 54. And if this activity gets completed in 20 days instead of 21, if you make certain arrangement because of which the activity F gets completed in 20, lesser days, okay, than the given days, then the project will get completed in lesser number of days, that is 52 days, right? Suppose say I do certain work, this activity gets delayed. This activity, instead of say 12 days, it gets completed in 14 days, 15 days. Still, my project will get completed in 53 days, because this activity is not contributing much to the project completion duration, as long as this node means to this node, you can delay the occurrence of this node by 6 days. Okay, if this node get delayed by 6 days, for example, we'll be seeing what happens if this node gets delayed by 6 days. Okay, suppose say this activity duration, instead of 12, this is 18. What is going to happen? 2 plus 18 plus 17 plus 18. So what is going to happen? 18 plus 18, 36 plus 17, 53. 18 plus 18, 36. 36 plus 10. 36, just let me, I'm sorry, this lag here is just of 4 days, not 6 days. okay, 14, 18 minus 14, 14. Now suppose say this activity gets delayed by 4 days. Okay, we'll be seeing what happens if this gets delayed by 4 days. Okay, after it gets delayed by 4 days, then only this activity will get critical. Okay, that means you need not have your serious focus on this activity. Just see what happens if this gets delayed by 4 days. 12 plus 4, 16. Okay, so let us take this set of activities which will be starting from node 1. And will help you reach to node 8. So 2 plus, instead of 12, I'll be taking 16. That is 18 plus 17, 35 plus 18, 53. So this becomes another critical path. Okay, but till this is means from 12 to 13 days, if this activity takes, it will not affect the project completion duration. Okay, but if this activity takes more than 16 days, then this is going to affect the project completion duration. Okay, so right now, all the activities on this network, all these activities on this path will directly affect the project completion duration. Right, if this activity gets delayed by 4 days or less, project completion duration remains unaffected. Right, is there any other activity which you can delay? I'm sorry, there is no activity. This activity also you can delay by sufficient amount. Okay, for example, here your T is 2 and this activity takes just 10 days, right? So you will be taking your TE to just 12, but you have the scope of reaching to 43, means you still have how much time? 53 minus 12, 53 minus 12 means 41 days. You can delay this activity by 41 days, okay? So if you focus all your attention to this activity, there is no point. Okay, if you focus all your attention on this activity or any other activity which you are not seeing on critical path, there is no point in focusing your attention. They are not critical activities, whereas all these activities are critical activities. Okay, so out of thousands of activity in the project, might be 100 of activity happen to be critical, which the attention or monitoring is to be carried out. That will help in better management of the project, and that is why critical path, finding critical path is very important. Now there are few more issues. I'll be completing the things in 5 to 10 minutes now. All right, there are few more issues. One is, what is the probability that the project will get completed in 53 days? The probability that the project will get completed in 53 days is 50%. Why? Because we have taken average times. Every activity duration we have taken average. So probability that project will get completed in 53 days is 50%. All right. Now, sometimes this is an interesting question. Like, what is the probability that the project will get completed in 55 days? Okay, what is the probability that the project will get completed in 55 days, 57 days? Okay, your manager vendor will always be asking you this kind of questions, right? What is the probability of completing the project in 55 days, 57 days? I'll be just taking one. That is, I'll be finding the probability of completing the project in 55 days, for example. Okay. So for finding the project completion probability that the project will be completed in 55 days, very simple formula is you find out value of z, okay, that is normal deviate. It is x minus mu by sigma. X minus mu by sigma. Oh, this is well known formula for finding normal deviate. Z is equal to x minus mu by sigma. Okay, it comes in various form. That is, x is equal to mu plus z sigma is again the same thing. Okay, right. So you will be finding normal deviate. Okay, you have been asked the probability of completing the project in 55 days. So your x is 55, mu you know, that is the mean project completion time, that is 53 days, okay, divided by sigma of critical path. Okay, now you have to find out sigma of critical path. Okay, means you can add. Okay, means you can add, and that is why I am saying that the average project completion duration is 53, because I have added means. But standard deviations you cannot add. Okay, you have found out standard deviation. This is the proper time when you should find out standard deviation only for the activities on critical path. You should not find it for all the activities. You will be finding it for A, C, F and J. For rest of the activities, there is no need of finding. So CP, I'll be finding sigma square CP. Okay, you can add variances, but you cannot add standard deviations. Okay, you can add means, you can add variances to get variance of the resultant thing. Okay, so I am adding variances. I have found the standard deviation of A, C, F and J that is available to me in the table. For activity A, it is 30.33 square, because the value there is the standard deviation. Then for activity C, it is 2.31 square. For activity, this activity was not there actually in the network information. This is for our convenience, we had as a dummy activity. Then activity F, the standard deviation for activity F, is 1. Alright, activity F, not 1, it is 5. Activity F, 5. So plus 5 square, I am adding variances. Right, then activity J. The standard deviation is 1.5. Okay, now so 1.5 square I will have to take. Okay, so sigma square CP and then sigma CP will be coming equal to, let me do the calculations. All right. So, sigma square CP, by doing this calculation, it comes equal to 32.695. Okay, this is the variance of the critical path, right? And therefore, the standard deviation of the critical path, sigma CP, will be square root of variance, as you know. So square root of 32.695 comes equal to 5.72. This is the standard deviation of the critical path. Okay, that was required in computing the value of normal deviate z. Okay, x we knew, that is the duration for which we need to find the probability. Okay, and 53 is the mean duration of project completion, 53 days, and sigma cp is 5.72. So this is 2 by 5.72, so 2 by 5.72 comes equal to, just let me see, 2 by 5.72 comes equal to 0.35. And if I refer normal distribution curve for this, so you use ND table, normal distribution table, okay, to find the cumulative probability at z equal to 0.35, and you will get the cumulative probability at z equal to 0.35 from normal distribution table, that comes equal to 63.66. That comes equal to 63.66. So probability of project completion, probability that project will complete in 55 days, all right, in 55 days is, how much did we find that out? 63.66 from normal distribution table, okay, is 53.66. All right. No, sorry, 63.66. Okay, let me check that once again. It is coming out to be 63.6667 to be precise. All right. So that is the probability of completing. And similar way, if you want to find the probability of project completion in 57 days, so it would be 57 minus 53 divided by 5.72. Okay, sigma cp is to be found just once, 5.72. Whatever that value comes, that will be value will be 0.7, and that 0.7 for z equal to 0.7, you will be getting cumulative probability from normal distribution table, and that will be the probability you are interested in. One more question I will be taking. Suppose say you are given, it might be a counter question, you tell me the duration within which the project will be completed with 99% probability. Okay, not 99, let's say, 99% probability. So what we will be doing, we'll be finding z value for 0.99 cumulative probability. Okay, duration. Here my question is, now finding the duration, duration, project completion duration. All right, project completion duration, which will be met with probability .99, or which will be made 99% of the time, with 99% confidence, right? So I'll be finding z for cumulative probability .99. Okay, so z for cumulative probability .99, let's find that out. Z for cumulative probability, I can find it from Excel. right, by using certain function called as a normal dot s dot distribution or normal dot s dot inverse. Okay, inverse is to be used when you want to find z, and distribution is to be used, dist is to be used when you want to find cumulative probability. So now I want to find z, so I'll be using the function, okay, norm dot dist. Actually I should use norm dot dist, okay, norm, this is the standard distribution, and norm, yes, what is it for, return the standard normal distribution that has a mean zero. Actually I want yes, okay, standard normal, norm dot s dot inverse, okay, for what, 0.99. actually you are supposed to find it by using normal distribution table, okay, 2.3263 it comes, 2.3263, 2.326 just enough for us, right? Now that I have z, okay, I'll be using the same formula, 2.326 is equal to x I want to compute, the duration which will be made with the probability of 0.99 I want to compute, 2.326, that is x mu I know to be 53 divided by 5.72, okay, so therefore x comes equal to 2.326 multiplied by 5.72 divided plus 53, so that comes equal to 66.30 days, okay. So CPM, this PERT is the important tool for finding out the critical path, not just the critical path, but some information like what is the probability of completing the project in specific number of days, or finding the number of days for completing the project with certain given probability, right? So that is PERT. And if you want to drill this problem by CPM perspective, you simply do not refer to this three time estimate. Assume that you are given this as the fixed time to complete this activity, find the critical path the way we have found it in PERT, and let us consider that as CPM. But in CPM, the flow of analysis is a bit different. In CPM, we find out various kinds of floats, which we'll be discussing in some other lecture. But for the purpose of this lecture, we are done, right? So I hope you have understood it. Okay. Thanks a lot for listening to this patiently. Thank you very much.